sponsored by Skillshare. I have a link for you to try them out for free at the end of the video. Hey, happy Friday. This week, Samsung announced that they're running out of chips as well as Note series phones. Wikipedia announced that they would actually like to start making some money. And Volkswagen announced that they're actually really serious about electric vehicles. As every week, we also have a brand new technology quiz. On popular demand, it is a lightning round again. So you only have 2 minutes to get 20 questions right. Links are in the description and welcome to the Friday checkout. Okay, my release highlights this week have to be the three excellent looking A-series smartphones Samsung have just announced. They feature 90 and 120Hz AMOLED screens, fancy triple cameras, dual speakers, waterproofing, 4 years of timely updates, and finally good Snapdragon 720 and 750 chips instead of weak Exynos ones they typically use. So basically anything you'd want from a phone, and they cost half of what flagships cost. I even like how they look, and unless the cameras end up being trash, I expect these to become extremely popular. Beside that, we have about 40 more new releases ranging from flagship phones from the likes of Red Magic to new TVs, all of which you can find in our weekly release monitor that is linked in the description. Check it out! Okay, my first story of the week will be Samsung announcing two things at their investor event yesterday. One, that they are essentially running out of chips for their phones, and two, that they either might delay or cancel the Note series this year. Now, originally people reported that the delay in the Note series was somehow connected to the chip shortage, which Samsung has since denied. They said that the two are unrelated and the delay is more general. And I have to say, I'm not too surprised about the Note, given that the company has three other flagships, of which two will apparently support digital pens already. But the chip shortage actually came as a bit of a surprise to me. As a reminder, Samsung is the only phone company in the world that actually manufactures the chip that they themselves use in their own phones, and they also buy chips from Qualcomm, which Samsung also manufactures. So if they can't even meet their own orders, it is likely that other phone makers will see similar crunches as well. By now, you have probably heard of chip shortages in the car industry that caused car factories around the world to shut down, and politicians around the world to take selfies holding chips to prove that they're serious or something. Or you might have heard of similar situations with graphics cards that mean gamers will have to basically hunt for new cards and game consoles as well. And it seems like this disease is spreading to other industries as well. Bloomberg reports that everyone except Apple is hit by the shortage, likely because their manufacturing partner TSMC just prioritizes them over everyone else, and Samsung forecasts that PCs and TVs will be next to get hit with the shortages, with companies like Taiwanese Asus Tech reporting that they're already 25 to 30% short on components. And if you're wondering why we are all suddenly out of chips, it is basically a super cycle of many things colliding. Everybody's stuck at home and buying work from home equipment, there's the huge Bitcoin mining craze, there's the huge rollout and build out of 5G network infrastructure, there's lots of investments into electric vehicles and autonomous driving, a new console generation. All of it is happening all at once, and the world just wasn't really prepared for that. And talking about electric vehicles, my second story of the week will be Volkswagen announcing that they're finally really serious about the category. And I don't typically talk about cars on my channel, but I think this is an interesting story. This week, Volkswagen had its so-called Power Day, which is basically a clone of Elon Musk's Battery Day, where the companies lay out their long-term plans for EVs and discuss their prospects primarily for investors. And judging by the fact that the company's share price jumped massively and had its best performance by far in over 5 years, it's very likely that investors liked what Volkswagen had to say. Basically, at Power Day, the company laid out that it would invest massively into new battery tech it calls unified cell batteries, as well as solid-state batteries. It would create 6 new manufacturing plants for batteries across Europe alone by the end of the decade. It would spend huge amounts of money building out its charging network across Europe, North America, and China. And it would enable two-way charging on most of its EVs by 2022. So your car can turn into a massive power bank for other cars or your house, for example. And if you thought to yourself, Power Day conferences, gigafactories, massive charging networks across North America, Europe, and China, those are things that Tesla likes to announce, Well, you're right, that's kind of the point here. Volkswagen has basically announced that they're copying many of the things that made Tesla successful and combining it with their massive scale that they hope will let them succeed. And investors seem to like the idea. Just for context, the Volkswagen Group typically sells somewhere between 8 to 10 million cars a year versus Tesla, who only sells about 500,000 for now. So there is a pretty major scale gap between the two. And even though I think Volkswagen has quite a lot of catching up to do in terms of technology, maybe they can use their scale to their advantage. And my third story of the week will be Wikipedia deciding it actually finally wants to make some money. And specifically, it is launching a paid API for enterprise customers. Now, Wikipedia is of course famously run by a non-profit, and its knowledge base is compiled mostly by volunteers, but lots of for-profit companies from Google to Amazon use that knowledge base, for example, as little boxes and search results, or as answers to your Alexa queries about how tall Mount Everest is. The way these giants currently take the data is by either taking the gigantic data dump Wikipedia creates once every 2 weeks or so for free, or by scraping Wikipedia's public sites, meaning that they basically use machines to download the information from public Wikipedia websites. And Wikipedia says that this is both kind of clunky and kind of unfair that all those companies then make money from their data and Wikipedia doesn't. So instead, they created a paid API. This is basically a way to let companies directly ping Wikipedia servers and receive specific results reliably and directly in machine-readable formats, with developer tools, support, and so on, which should be much more seamless for the companies and should also get Wikipedia paid. It's a voluntary system for now, and the old methods are still available, so we'll have to wait to see how well it gets adopted, but that's the basic idea. And this is relevant for two main reasons. First, the Wikimedia Foundation is of course a non-profit and has been for many, many years. They collect about $100 million every year from their users as donations, and I myself donate to them every year as well. Them relying on commercial revenue is a big deal. And while they say that that revenue will only make up a minor portion of their income, there is a real risk that they would be less independent in the future. And second, many website owners and regulators around the world are in big, messy fights with web platforms such as Google over exactly this kind of business model, where the web platforms essentially extract information from websites, they make money with that and funnel very little of that money back to the original content creators. You might have heard of the pretty terrible Australian attempt, which basically ended in a failed link tax. Europe is considering to create their own version of that law, and there is a general sense that the industry as a whole should adopt some kind of scheme of payment here. And Wikipedia might just be showing us one of the alternatives for that. Now, I have a question for you. What do you think you're looking at right now? You have probably guessed that it is some form of art, but you might not have guessed that these images were not only created with what is known as generative art, meaning primarily with the use of computer algorithms, but that they're also class projects from students of one of the coolest Skillshare classes out there. The class literally teaches you how to code art, right from setting up your machine to creating really advanced projects, all with a super engaging teacher. It is really Skillshare at its best, and generative art is just one of the thousands of fantastic classes on Skillshare, with others including things like logo design or coding your own animation using CSS, or classes on specific software such as Figma or After Effects. Whether you're getting started as a new photographer or designer, or just want to level up your editing skills, Skillshare is a place dedicated to helping you learn something new and to improving yourself. The first 1,000 people to sign up using my link in the description will get a free trial of Skillshare Premium, and if you decide to keep it, it's less than 10 bucks a month for an annual subscription. So check it out, happy learning, and I'll see you next Friday.